procedural programming paradigms where you essentially write down a recipe, a series of instructions that the computer goes through, updates variables, and at the end it calculates a return value by following each step of the recipe very carefully. Rule-based programming and functional programming are what are called declarative languages, and here you're not telling the computer so much what to do, but you're describing properties of the calculation you want to compute, and the programming language works out everything else for itself. So it's really kind of clever way to be able to program, but is not so commonly used as procedural programming. Each of these paradigms could have an entire unit based on it, and in fact many of them have had entire units on them, but we're just going to go through these and just to make sure that you're familiar with the concepts, and hopefully it will spark enough of an interest for you to go and explore these concepts further. Okay, so let's get back to Mathematica, and the first principle of Mathematica: everything is an expression, and every expression has a set head and a sequence of arguments, and the same goes for programs. So programs are built in this same way. So examples, we might have a list. So let's just pull up a new notebook. So if we've got a list of the numbers 1 up to 5, and we can call this variable L, it gives us it writes it down as a list. But if we want to actually interpret this as an expression or see how it is from the Mathematica point of view, we can use the full form function that we've discussed earlier. And the variable is called L, not list. And it shows that the actual expression for a list is the head, which says how to calculate the expression, and then a list of arguments, or a sequence of arguments. Likewise, if we have r equals 3 divided by 5, that's fine. The full form of r is the rational 3, 5. And likewise, for larger calculations, the derivative of the first derivative of f, a function which times f times x on 2, gets expressed this way. And at the base of every one of these expressions, there are these atoms, the numbers 3, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, symbols, things like f and x over here, and strings. So if we want to put in messages or names, these sorts of things, there's the string type. Okay, and numbers are further divided into integers, rationals, reals, and complex. So this is what's at the base of the language that we'd want to write programs for. Now, a program is kind of similar to a function. Well, in many cases, is exactly equal to a function. But there's a number of different ways that we can write functions in Mathematica. So if I say x squared plus 2x plus 3, and call this f because it's a function, Mathematica is fine with that. And if I actually want to do the calculation, what is f of 3? I can write f with x map 2, which is just the dash and greater than x map to 3. And it replaces x in this expression, and then it simplifies it and it gets 18. Now, we have evaluated the function. F does describe a function, but this is different to a program from our point of view, because really what's happened is f is just an expression in this case. So it's an expression that works this way. We replaced x in this expression with 3, and then Mathematica just applied some simplification rules, and it returned the expression, which is basically just the atomic number 18. So it didn't really go through a program, it was just a set, it was just evaluated. then completely reevaluate the right hand side. So just to see the things that can potentially go wrong, if I have x equals 4, so now I've stored x as 4 in the memory, and then I say f of x underscore, first of all it evaluates that entire function, gives us 27, and then stores that value of f of x. Now if I asked it to calculate f of 5, this tells me 27. If I ask for f of 3, it tells me 27. That's because it had a value for x, it inserted the value for x, it simplified the expression, and now it basically just interpreted the whole thing. Now if we want to see what's going on, question mark f, it evaluated the whole expression as 27, so f of x equals 27. So what we need to do to stop it doing that, we don't want it to use a current value for x into memory, we want it to wait until x is passed to the function, okay? And now if we go and look at what the value of f of x is, it's x squared plus 2x plus 3, and we can try evaluating it with the different functions. 5 gives us 38, 3 gives us 18. So every time we get a new value for x, we're recomputing the value for f. So an example to see what this is, we can define two functions here, which are zero place functions. So rand immediate equals random real. So what this is going to do is this is going to give us a random number. Okay? It's given us a random number now of 0.632. Rand delay equals, this time colon equals random real. So now every time we call this function, it's going to call random real. And now we use the table. Now what table does is it creates a list by calling this function as many times as we ask it to. So we want rand delay, comma, 3. That's every time it's gone through, it's called a different, called random, the random number generator, and it's generated 3 different random numbers. Now if we call the same function, this time we're using the immediate version, three times again. It's called 3 times, and because this was evaluated when we created the function, and it's never evaluated again, it's given us the same random number 3 times over. Okay. Most programs that do complex tasks are more than just a single one-line function. There's a lot of things you have to check for, do, and modify, and build up. So there are a number of ways to have this sort of complexity in Mathematica. So there's procedural expressions, things like if x is greater than 0, and then what you do if x is greater than 0, this is the return value here, x. What you do if x is not greater than 0, minus x, and what you do if you don't know what value to use for x. You can also use list comprehensions. So let's have a quick look at some of these functions. We've got slash semicolon, you read it as the word where. So we want to replace x where x is less than 0. And that should be mapped to negative x. So all of this here is the replacement rule. It takes, matches any x where x is less than 0, and it replaces it with negative x. So if we do this, actually let's make it interesting because that's not going to give us anything useful. If we go range from minus 5 to 5 and replace everything that is less than 0 with the negative of itself, we should get 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. So range negative 5. These would have been negative 5, negative 4, negative 3, negative 2, negative 1. And we've replaced them all with the negative of themselves, so they've become positive again. Okay, so that's a way that you can use kind of a complicated function to achieve a result that you're looking for. Okay, other ways of doing the absolute value function, we can have just do a definition. So the function abs hasn't been defined. I think there's probably an abs with a capital A in it because that's the convention Mathematica uses. But x blank where x is less than 0 equals minus x. Okay. And abs of x blank where x is greater than or equal to 0 equals x. So we've now put two rules in. So we're not redefining the absolute value here. So this is the absolute value for all x where x is less than 0, and this is the absolute value for x where x is greater than or equal to 0. So these two definitions have been stored. Let's see what it says about abs now. Well, it's got two rules associated with it, and it's going to go through and it's going to match those. So if we pass it a variable, it's going to try and match those rules, and if it finds the rule that matches, it's just going to return the right-hand side. So this is what's called rule-based programming. So if we say abs of minus 2, matched the first rule, gave us the negative of minus 2. We say abs of 2, came through, didn't match the first rule, but did match the second rule, gives us 2. And if we say abs of dog, went all the way through, didn't match any rule, didn't know what to do with it, so just gave us the function call back again. Okay, so that's the way rule-based programming works, and that can be very powerful, particularly when you look at some of the computations that we do, where, you know, when you're simplifying or expanding trigonometry and these sorts of things, or using calculus, you're really looking for a rule that fits, and then you want to be able to apply that rule, simplify things down, and get a symbolic solution. So that's very powerful in Mathematica. The final way is one of these things that we saw at the end of the last lecture, which uses this hash function. So hash just matches a value, so x, and then we use sine, whatever that value is. So sine hash is going to give us minus 1 if it's a negative number, and 1 if it's a positive number. And what we've done here, just to make life really, really cryptic, is we've taken the argument, the first argument, and there's a space here, so that means that we multiply the two terms together. So we have the number multiplied by the sign of the number. So if it's negative, we're going to multiply it by minus 1. If it's positive, we're going to multiply it by 1. Okay, so now we say, what's f? And, well, it's told us that if we get... it's now got two definitions. One is a fixed function, and the other one is this term here. So it's a little bit confusing. Let's clear f. Okay. And then we can just go back up to this term here, execute that again. And now we ask for f. It's now definitely just the second definition. And we say f of 3 gives us 3. F of minus 3 also gives us 3. So lots of different ways to use the absolute value